This is Duke University.
Grace and peace to you in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, and welcome to worship on this beautiful morning. We are excited to have Dr. John Kinney with us as our guest preacher on this MLK Sunday. Dr. Kinney is the Dean of the School of Theology at Virginia Union University. We're also excited to have the Duke Jazz Ambassadors with us today and are always happy to have their musical accompaniment during worship. So thank you all. Duke undergraduates, this is your opportunity to preach in that pulpit. The applications for Student Preacher Sunday are due next Monday, and information on that process can be found on our chapel website or in your bulletin. Today is Martin Luther King Jr. Sunday, and the university service of commemoration is this afternoon at 3:00 right here in this place. The Reverend Dr. William Turner from Duke Divinity School will be the speaker at this event, and we invite you all to come and join the larger Duke and Durham community for that celebration as well. Tomorrow is a day of service at the university, and there will be a meal packaging event, Million Meals packaging event, in the intramural building. And if you are looking for a way to give back tomorrow out of gratitude for all that you have, then we encourage you to be a part of that event as well. Now please stand as we lift our voices to God.
This morning, the Spirit is moving at the altar of our hearts. So let us lift our voices and pray. God of our weary years, God of our silent tears, we confess that many times our feet stray from the places and paths where we met thee. Lord, have mercy. Precious Lord Jesus, we acknowledge that we have come over a way that with tears has been watered due to the sorrow and pain we have perpetuated when we have not lifted our voices against injustice, but rather have remained sadly silent. Christ, have mercy. Holy Spirit, we repent for the ways that we contribute to the death of hope unborn. Lord, have mercy. Brothers and sisters, if we lift our voices to confess our sin, God is faithful and just to forgive our sin and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And by doing so, God brings us out from a gloomy past into a bright future. This is the good news of the gospel, that in Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Amen. Let us share the forgiveness, peace, and love of Christ with one another.
Please join me in the prayer for illumination. God of all mercy, your Son proclaimed good news to the poor, release to the captives, and freedom to the oppressed. As your word is proclaimed in our midst, anoint us with your Holy Spirit and set all your people free to praise you in Christ our Lord. Amen. The Old Testament lesson is from Isaiah, the 62nd chapter. For Zion's sake, I will not keep silent, and for Jerusalem's sake, I will not rest until her vindication shines out like the dawn and her salvation like a burning torch. The nations shall see your vindication and all the kings your glory, and you shall be called by a new name that the mouth of the Lord will give. You shall be a crown of beauty in the hand of the Lord, and a royal diadem in the hand of your God. You shall no more be termed forsaken, and your land shall no more be termed desolate. But you shall be called, my delight is in her, and your land married. For the Lord delights in you, and your land shall be married. For as a young man marries a young woman, so shall your builder marry you. And as the bridegroom rejoices over the bride, so shall your God rejoice over you. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you.
The New Testament lesson is from 1 Corinthians, the 12th chapter. Now concerning spiritual gifts, brothers and sisters, I do not want you to be uninformed. You know that when you were pagans, you were enticed and led astray to idols that could not speak. Therefore, I want you to understand that no one is speaking by the Spirit of God ever says, "Let Jesus be cursed," and no one can say, "Jesus is Lord," except by the Holy Spirit. Now there are varieties of gifts, but the same Spirit. And there are varieties of services, but the same Lord. And there are varieties of activities, but it is the same God who activates all of them in everyone. To each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. To one is given through the Spirit the utterance of wisdom, and to another the utterance of knowledge according to the same Spirit. To another faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healing by the one Spirit, to another the working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another the discernment of spirits, to another various kinds of tongues, to another the interpretation of tongues. All these are activated by one and the same Spirit, who allots to each one individually just as the Spirit chooses. This is the word of the Lord.
The gospel lesson is from John, the 11th chapter. Then Jesus, again greatly disturbed, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone was lying against it. Jesus said, "Take away the stone." Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, "Lord, already there is a stench because he has been dead for 4 days." Jesus said to her, "Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone. And Jesus looked upwards and said, "Father, I thank you for having heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I have said this for the sake of the crowd standing here, so that they may believe that you sent me." When he had said this, he cried with a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out!" The dead man came out, his hands and feet bound with strips of cloth, and his face wrapped in a cloth. Jesus said to them, "Unbind him and let him go." This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you. may be seated. Unto the only one wise God, our Lord, the God who has made us majestically, loved us amazingly, and empowered us completely. To that God be all glory, honor, power, and dominion. As we celebrate this moment and honor the God who gives us this moment, this season has us giving attention to two significant moments. Beyond the liturgical calendar, all eyes are toward Washington at a time of transition and initiation. This year it converges with remembrance of Martin Luther King, Jr. A couple weeks ago, I had occasion to be with some young people. They were having a moment where they were supposed to be learning about Martin Luther King, and I heard the lady who was teaching them say, "Who was Martin Luther King?" And one of the young boys said, "My daddy said he was one of those holy rollers." And I was there to discuss Martin Luther King, and so trying to remember all those things I had been taught about faith development and human development, to provide a note that was age appropriate, I began to talk about the significance and the importance of this hero and the remarkable gifts of mind, person, and spirit that were shared in such a way that he transformed this nation and the world. But the next day in my devotional, I was reading the text that you heard read. And as I reflected upon that, I said, I should have told that young man, yes, he was a holy roller. How so? You see the text. The text says that a dear friend of Jesus had died, Lazarus. He was delayed in coming. Jesus spoke to them and reminded them that he was the resurrection and the life. And as he saw people crying, the word says that Jesus wept. Then he asked a question, "Show me where you laid him." And the spirit within him groaned. And then he said, "Roll the stone away. Take the stone away." His own sister said, "But Lord, my brother has been dead for 4 days. And by now, you can't do a thing with him because he smells." Jesus said, "Didn't I tell you if you'd only believe, you would see the glory of God?" And the word says, they rolled the stone away. I want to suggest that all of us ought to be holy rollers. Not in some ecstatic, demonstrative demonstration, but we are the holy people who roll the stones away. This text took me back to my very early years growing up in Wheeling, West Virginia, when there lived next door to me a man by the name of George Hawkins. His personal biography and story were beyond reliable deconstruction and reliable construction. But they said that he had migrated to West Virginia to work in the coal mines, and he had come from the islands, the South Sea Islands. His back recalled the slaver's track. The slope in his shoulders told you of the weight that he had borne. His deeply furrowed and glistening brow told you of the agony that he had known. But the lines disappearing at the corners of his mouth into that graying beard let you know that he had smiled at adversity. The saintly words that rolled off his lips through snaggled teeth colored with age told you of a deep and abiding faith. And the silver crown of gray hair that encircled his ebony bald spot let you know that he was soon to transition from time and to walk in the halls of eternity. Every night, weather permitting, he would come out and sit down in an orange rocker with the arms worn bare by age. And he would prop his stiff leg up on a homemade crutch and stick a whittled pipe into his mouth, smoking I know not what. But at the first puff of smoke, this little 7 and 8 year old boy would run to sit at the feet of George Hawkins. One night as I sat there, he said, "Billy, be still. The spirits are moving." And I said, "Mr. Hawkins, I don't see anything." He said, "No, because you don't have the gift that I have. I was born with a veil over my eyes, and I can see the spirit world." And he said, "They're coming now." And I looked out over and tried to see what was coming down the road with more of a cobblestone road, and I saw nothing. And I said, "Mr. Hawkins, I don't see anything, nothing." He said, "No, son, let me show you. Watch that dog walking up the path. Dogs discern what we have to have a gift to see." And sure enough, that dog stopped, bent back on its hind haunches, tail stuck straight up in the air, ears stood up, and the dog stood still, and then it yelped and woo, 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 and ran off. And about that time, I was ready to run off. But in my youth, I strained to see what Mr. Hawkins saw, and I must confess to you, I never can see exactly what he saw. But I have lived long enough now to discover that folk that you want to put in a grave and declare dead can rise up and walk. And what this word reminds us, that the Lord could have gotten Lazarus up any kind of way. He could have shattered the rock. But he assigned the people of God with a task. I want you all to be my holy rollers. Roll the stone away. Look at the text. There's a crisis. Somebody has died that the Lord loved. And the response of Jesus lets you know that this death was neither a part of the divine design, decree, or intent. Because when Jesus saw and the grief, and he not only saw it, he felt it. Tears etched a briny path down his cheeks and fell upon a heaving chest that housed a broken heart that was pierced by the pathos of unfulfilled promise. He wept. He cared. Then he said, "Show me where you laid him." The grave was a stone with a cave with a stone rolled over. He said, "Rolled away." Mary said, "Can't do that. He stinks." What's the crisis? The crisis is that people that God does not intend to be lost and confined to a grave are being placed in holes and they're having stones rolled over them. I can't see the literal dead rising, but I can look across the world and identify groups and people assigned to a dead place and defined as stinky. The tragedy is not only that Lazarus is dead, but the tragedy is even deeper because his sister is in the grave with him. Because the deeper crisis is when God speaks a possibility for your brother and your sister, and you would rather believe the world's definition of their purpose and their destiny rather than accept with Christ all things are possible. She immediately says, He's been dead 4 days. I have been logically taught, and I understand the death process. After 4 days, decomposition begins to set in. If you had been here yesterday, according to my science and my world logic, something could have happened. But these folk have been dead too long for anybody to do anything with them. So, Lord, don't let those stinky people out, and certainly don't bring them in here. Jesus says, roll the stone away. What happens when we who are deeply committed to God begin to allow the world's definition of human possibility dictate our behavior rather than an honest encounter with God that leads to a metanoia of consciousness, transforms our reflection, our vision, and our behavior? How often do we want to tell the Lord what to do with folk rather than respond to the invitation of the Lord? Roll the stone away. And rather than invite a life-giving possibility, we tell God, this is how it must be done. Nothing exists in isolation. We're all connected. We all exist in a web of mutuality and reciprocity. One of the characteristics of fallenness is hierarchical fragmentation and alienation, where we fail to recognize how we're connected. A Jewish rabbi was teaching novitiates, and he asked them a question: when do you know that you've seen the light? That was their question early in the morning. And as the dawn came, they began to try to figure it out, and they looked out and they said, I know. And they looked out and they said, on the horizon, I see a lamb and a wolf. The light has come when you know the difference between the lamb and the wolf. I said, no. Another one said, I know, I see it. When you can tell the difference between the pear and the persimmon tree. And he said, no. He said, well, they said, when does the light come? And the rabbi said, until you know every man is your brother and every woman is your sister, you still walk in darkness and you have not seen the light. I had to learn this in the third grade at Lincoln School in Wheeling, West Virginia. Grades 1 through 12, you had one teacher for each grade. The third grade was Gertrude Dixon. I was in the second grade, but Isla Williams died and they didn't have another African-American teacher to teach us, so they combined the second and third grade, and I was taught my times tables in the third grade by Gertrude Dixon, and I was not taught multiplication factors. She said timetable. There was no such thing as ability grouping. She was not worried about damaging my psyche. She wanted me to master basic math, and so before the whole class, you had to stand up and learn your timetable, and she had charts that she pulled down. That was high tech because it used to be written on the blackboard. Now you got charts that we pulled down, and she had a pointer that she pointed, and you would go around the room and say your times table, and you would have to get up before the whole class, and you would go around and excuse me, but in those days we learned with a rhythm. It was not just quiet and still. She had a stick that she pointed with, a stick that she tapped the floor, and that stick was the one she also tapped your hand, and she would get a beat, and you had to learn the beat. You know, 2 times 2 is 4. 2 times 3 is 6. Class would be rocking. 2 times 4 is 8. And then you would have to, after you did that, she had another sheet that was blank, and she would pull it down. And she'd go up and go around and point for each student, and you had to say it. I did mine, you all. A second grader mastering the third grade curriculum. I can remember this day, the last one, 12 times 12, 144. And excuse me. And I went back to my seat. She just told me, Mr. Kinney, you did great. The next person after me messed up on 4 times 4. And when he messed up, I said, oh! Miss Dixon hit that board, walked back to me, and said, Mr. Kinney, I told you you did well, but you just showed me you don't have what it takes to do well. She said, hold out your hand, and I thought I was going to get the rod. She put Jimmy's hand in my hand and said, Mr. Kinney, till Mr. Smith passes, you don't pass. And I lost my recess and my playtime tutoring another child that I had laughed at. And the next time he got up there, I wasn't laughing, I was praying. Help him, Lord. You help him. And I learned a lesson in the 3rd grade that has stuck in my soul all of my life. You cannot succeed and claim your greatness while you're laughing at somebody else who is failing. Look what happens, there's a crisis. Then Jesus makes a command, roll the stone away. Roll the stone away. Because see, what the text reveals is it's not enough to declare somebody dead. I must put in place structural realities that reinforce my power of nomination. What did I just say? I just can't say you're dead. I got to make sure you stay in a dead place and make sure your death doesn't pollute me. And I see myself as the privileged sweet one, and you are the stinky ones, and I have structures to make sure that that doesn't pollute me. And all, sometimes we don't roll stones around them. Over them, we build tracks down the middle, highways around, develop policies that exclude. Roll the stone away. They said I only had 20 minutes, so let me roll this sermon on. No, now look. There's a crisis to which Jesus makes a command. Here's what I want my people to do. Those of you who believe in me, if I'm going to reach the world, some of you think you reach because you preach. I can preach, Jesus says. I'll preach. I'll tell him, come out. I need some folk who are committed enough to address the structures of separation built based upon your premature assumptions about somebody else's condition, and you define them based upon that rather than me. And I am in your midst. Roll the stone away. Look what the text says. I believe I'm with the they this morning. They rolled the stone away, not Jesus. And could we miss it in our ecclesiologies? That there are 2 assignments given to the people of God. Roll the stone and loose them once they get out. I'll get them out if you just move the stones and you loose. They, you go from a crisis to a command to some committed folk who rolled the stone away, because not everybody was committed. Take time to read the text, and it says some of them went back and told the Pharisees what they were doing. That over at Duke, they have the nerve to be rolling stones. And we know we don't have that on our campus. Now, why do people refuse to roll stones away? One, oftentimes it's just stolid acceptance of a normative pattern of operation which you have lost the capacity to question anymore. You just do it because that's the way we've always done it. And I'm following policy. Others are conscious that they're doing it because they recognize that keeping the stone in place affords privilege for me. And after I get privilege from anything, even if it's oppressive, I want to preserve my privilege, not set somebody free. Now look what they, and I go to the Pharisees. Why? I want to use religion to promote my privilege, so I make sure that I associate in a religious context where I won't hear people saying, roll the stone away. I'm going to the Pharisees because they'll say he's dead and he stinks. But also, could it be as we bring this to a close, that we can't roll stones because we've been appeased. I have to run back because my 16-year-old granddaughter is having her, my granddaughter is having her 16th birthday, and she says she wanted to have it with granddaddy. Amen. I love all of you all, but she'll be 16 one time. And I don't want you all to go out of here saying, oh, wasn't he a wonderful man? And then my grandchildren don't even know me. When my daughter, who is the mother of that 16-year-old, when we were in New York City doing PhD studies, my parents were in West Virginia, and we used to have to drive there. We would leave New York City, and my daughter would be in the back seat with her brother, and the first thing to come out of her mouth is, are we there yet? I have matured some since that period, but I want you to know it was great difficulty that I endured every 5 miles, are we there yet? Because grandmama had a place for her where she had all these stuffed animals, and she couldn't wait to get to grandmama because grandmama was sweet to her all the time. Grandmama was not the woman that raised me. Bill Cosby says they're getting old and they're trying to go to heaven. No, everything she wanted, that's all she, Daddy, come on, are we there yet? And I'm saying, no, we're only 2 miles further than we were the last time you asked that question. But at that time, they were building McDonald Playlands on the turnpike. We went into the McDonald's Playland, got her a little bit, and she went, can I play? I said, go ahead. We're ready to go. And I'm trying to find her. And she's buried in the Playland. And I said, come on, Erica, it's time to go to grandma's house. Oh, do we have to? And some of us have confused the promised land for our playlands. We have become so comfortable in our playlands, we don't even think about the promised land. But there is a word that says, where have you laid me? And in the midst of people who are dying, will you be a holy roller and roll the stone away? Roll till justice flows like a river and righteousness like a mighty stream. Roll till every valley is exalted, every mountain is made low, and every crooked place is made straight. Roll till the calf and the lion walk together, and a child leads them. Roll till good news is preached to the poor, the captives are released, the blind see, and wounds are bound up where everyone has access to health care. Roll till we see a new heaven and a new earth. Roll till we can join Martin Luther King and say, free at last, free at last. Thank God Almighty, free at last. Are there any holy rollers in the house?
The Lord be with you. Let us pray using the litany for Martin Luther King Sunday printed in your bulletin. God of justice and mercy, you have given us a great cloud of witnesses who made the long walk to freedom and are still a pillar of cloud marking the path today. For Sojourner Truth, Frederick Douglass, Nat Turner, Richard Allen, and all who lived and persevered through times when hope was dim, we give you thanks and praise. For Harriet Tubman, Ida Wells Barnett, Paul Lawrence Dunbar, Marcus Garvey, James Weldon Johnson, J. Rosamond Johnson, and all who dreamed the dream and gave it song, we give you thanks and praise. For W.E.B. Du Bois, Booker T. Washington, Mary Church Terrell, Septima Clark, and all who upheld the dream through times of doubt and sorrow, we give you thanks and praise. For James Baldwin, Howard Thurman, Langston Hughes, Mary McLeod Bethune, and all who sustained the dream and gave it voice, we give you thanks and praise. For Rosa Parks, Martin Luther King Jr., Ella Baker, and all who lived the dream, we give you thanks and praise. For Paul Robeson, Fannie Lou Hamer, A. Philip Randolph, Adam Clayton Powell, Polly Murray, and all who have carried the dream forward through times of tragedy and joy, we give you thanks and praise. Make us, Lord, a people who cherish the memory of the examples you lay before us. Honor the struggle of those who continue to give their lives to make your dream come true, and seek through your Son to make that dream our dream, so that we too may enter the richness of your glory. Amen. Now I invite Liza Brown Pinsky to come forward with our mission of the month.
On behalf of the Duke Durham Neighborhood Partnership and the Office of Durham and Regional Affairs, we are glad to partner with Duke Chapel and the Faith Council for the Martin Luther King Jr. Million Meals event on Monday. Today's offering will support this event, and tomorrow, 1,000 volunteers from Duke, North Carolina Central University, and the Durham community will package 80,000 meals to be shipped to countries in need. We will be working with Stop Hunger Now, a faith-based organization that believes that all people of faith have a divine mandate to work toward a just and peaceful world. We appreciate your generous offering, and to all participating in tomorrow's event, thank you.
Thank you. With glad and generous hearts, may we return our gifts to God's service.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Precious Lord, our rejoicing rises high as the listening skies in gratitude to you for bringing us thus far on the way and leading us into the light of your glory. May these gifts be used to create harmonies of liberty for your creation. On this day, we give thanks for those who have rolled stones away, and for those who have dreamed dreams and had visions of justice and mercy for a beloved community. Those who recognize that we are more alike than different. Those in Durham and beyond who strive to nurture and build relationships across socioeconomic and racial lines. We thank you for organizations and entities such as the Department of Biology at Duke, who helps us study and learn how living organisms interact with each other and the environment, such that we realize our interdependence. Continue to give us such an awareness of your loving ecology of grace, mercy, justice, love, and peace, that we may discover deep joy in the community of creation. May we march on with a steady beat forever in your path, singing a song full of the faith that the dark past has taught us, singing a song full of the hope that the present has brought us. As we face the rising sun of the new day begun, let us always pray the prayer Jesus taught his disciples till victory is won. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And may the grace and love of the Lord Jesus Christ, the justice and mercy of God, and the peace of the Holy Spirit roll down like waters and an ever-flowing stream upon your life, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you.